One of the things that Steve spoke about this last Sunday was fruit and cultivating that in your life, and how we do the work, but God kind of brings that to fruition in our everyday lives. And soon, we're going to be starting the 21 days of prayer. And I think it's important that we be praying about that fruit to come about in our lives. And basically, when fruit is being talked about, they're talking about three things. They're talking about Christian character, Christian conduct, and Christian converts. And what I'd like to do is kind of just talk about those three things, okay? We're actually going to be incorporating some things in that prayer guide, or Steve has, into the prayer guide about how to be praying for other people to come to church and all those other kinds of things. And so I thought this might be kind of a good connector, okay? And the first thing is this. It really is about Christian character. That's one of the things that God develops in us. And Christian character is what happens on the inside. It's what happens in our heart. It's the things that we think about when we wake up first thing in the morning. It's the things a minute after our head hits the pillow, the thoughts that we allow to kind of rummage around inside our heads. And how are we kind of living on the inside? What are the attitudes that we're cultivating? What are the things, just like the fruit of the Spirit, are we cultivating love, joy, peace, patience, and etc.? And also, it's not just that, but I believe it's our interpretation of the events and the things and the people and the reactions and all of the things that take place around us. How are we looking at that? Are we looking at that the way God does, or are we looking at it the way that, well, another way? And so it says here in 1 Timothy 6:6 that that godliness with contentment is great gain. Godliness with contentment, and contentment is a choice. It is something that you cultivate. It is something that you work hard to bring about. God doesn't just sprinkle it on you. It is something that you work to have. There's an author by the name of Tom Rath, and he wrote an excellent book. I highly recommend it to everyone here, called It's Not About You. And he talks about how every day he gets up and he asks himself the question, who is someone that I can make an impact on today? A positive impact, somebody that can uplift, I can encourage, I can bring along, I can strengthen, any of those things. Despite the fact that he is a man that was born with a horrible disease, his body produces tumors. Just like seeds in a watermelon. I mean, they're just his body just makes, just they just, he just produces tumors. It's the craziest thing. And he has had dozens of surgeries on his glands, his lungs, his brain, and his spine. If there is anything, if there's anyone that could really dig into pain, and not to undersell this, but inconvenience, it would be him. And yet, his outlook is others. His outlook is character. His outlook is reaching out and encouraging and uplifting and impacting other people. Now, Christian character is something that we cultivate every single day, and it is something that we strive to grow in. And some days we do well, and some days we don't do so well. But it's something that we should be working on every single day. So we have Christian character, and we also need to cultivate Christian conduct. And that is basically how we interact with the people around us, how we talk to them, and how we behave, how we express ourselves. There's a great verse in Proverbs 4:23. It says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. One of the things that I find, and y'all have heard me gripe about this before, but it just seems like every day, the great American pastime now is to wake up, get out of bed, and try to figure out, who are we supposed to be angry at today? Who has messed up so that we can just shame them on Twitter, or just rake them over the coals, or get mad at that political party, or that view about that thing, or this idea about that other thing? And I'm just over it. you know? I'm just so tired of it. It just gets so old. And I was with some family over the holidays, and there was a bunch of us there, and we were all kind of talking, you know? And politics slowly started to kind of creep into the conversation. And I said, you know what? I'm a pastor. I have all kinds of illustrations. So let me share one with you. On the west side of North Carolina, there are all kinds of mountains, and some of them have caves. And you can go inside those caves, and you can see the stalactites and the stalagmites. And there's even one that has a stream running out of it. Don't know where the water comes up, but that's what kind of hollowed out that cave over the millennia. And inside that stream are fish. Fish completely cut off from the world, blind because of the darkness. They have no contact with anything. And they shouldn't be there, and yet there they are. And those fish care more about politics than I ever will. And he was like, no, okay. And it just kind of, and it just kind of shut it down. One of the things that I believe as Christians, that, and we could talk about all kinds of behaviors, all kinds of things. But one very good example, I think, of this is just the fact that we're supposed to be angry every single day. And I think as Christians, it is our job to, one, not easily offend, and two, not be easily offended. We are to not easily offend and not be easily offended. Because we're called to live differently. And the Bible makes that very, very clear. And then the last one is Christian converts. One of the things that I encourage people to do is to, I call it 5, 5, and 5. And I know that I heard a great quote about this not too long ago. And he said that basically Christians and non-Christians have one thing in common, and they both hate evangelism. One of the things that we need to realize is that somebody went out of their way, conjured the boldness to share Jesus with us, and we should be doing the same. And one of the things that I encourage everyone to do is don't go knocking on doors. Don't do that. One of the things I encourage people to do is 5, 5, and 5. 5 times a week for 5 minutes each time, pray for 5 people. Just put 5 people on that list. And with that, pray for the opportunities to be seen. A chance to just say, hey, I'm praying for you, a chance to encourage them, and maybe even the chance to invite them to church. And God is the one, as Steve said last Sunday, God is the one that orchestrates these things, and he is the one that brings out the fruit if we simply make ourselves available, okay? And so we want to make sure that we are doing those things. We need to make sure that those are things so that God can work. One of the things that I thought was very interesting is somebody, I don't know how you even measure such a thing, but somebody measured the amount of work a farmer does versus the amount of work nature does when growing a crop. And the farmer only puts in 5%. I mean, and they're up at an ungodly hour and doing, you know, working all day. It's a rough life. And yet everything that they do is really just 5% of what contributes to the overall produce. So we need to make sure that we are staying in connection with God and ask him what he may want us to do and where he may want us to go. One of the things that is tough with all of this is sometimes we're trying to do the things, we're trying to do all the Jesus things, we're trying to do all the good stuff, and we're not really sure if it's making an impact. And I think it was about a year, maybe probably over a year ago, we were all out there in the big parking lot. We're all kind of having a shindig. And it was pastor appreciation / several other things. We're tired of COVID, let's get together kind of thing, breathe on each other. I think that was the name of the event. So And I was not doing well. Blame it on bad attitude, blame it on COVID, blame it on being shut in, blame it on whatever you want. I had a bad attitude. And just didn't really feel like anything was happening with the stuff that I was doing. And God has very good timing where there are times where that can kind of creep into at least my life, and God just kind of comes in and hits me over the head with a shovel. I was talking to a guy, and he said, "Hey, man, I want to bend your ear about something." And my first thought was, "What complaint am I going to hear now?" And he said, "I was talking to this guy, and he and his wife, they had lost their child, and they came here years ago. And you and Angie, you sat down with them, and you talked them through that, and you showed them some of the things that they're going to encounter, some of the rough roads, how they can pull through that, and you were just there to listen. Both of you were there to listen and give advice and just encourage them." And even though that was like 7-8 years ago, he remembered what you did. And I was like, "All right, God, I get it. You know, just kind of that, you know, sometimes we just kind of wallow in that misery. And I was like, and we're not always going to see. And we've all heard that. We all know that. But knowing that is really hard on that day-to-day basis. But if you're putting out the effort that God has called you to do, he is going to be working ways, many times in ways that you don't see, and he's going to bring about that fruit. Okay? At this time, I've asked Steve to do communion.